Today we're going to talk a little bit about AI agents and whether AI agents are actually taking developer jobs. Agents are and will remain pretty dumb. This is my take on this. Reality is a complex and difficult to understand place, even for us. When we leave AIs up to their own devices, they really also don't know quite what to make of the world. This is counter to what you might hear a lot about AI agents and even what large mega corporations are talking about when it comes to AI. Amazon released Q, which is one of their AI agents that they're deploying across their AWS infrastructure. And Q was able to transform an existing application and upgrade the package versions of it. There's a lot of companies doing this, and AWS is just the latest in a long stream of these. But I'll tell you why this isn't quite as impressive as you might think. The thing about this problem of upgrading some initial program using an AI agent to a changed program using Java is that there is a very clear understanding of what the constraints are for a specific program. It's also able to get feedback as it attempts to solve the problem. So when we upgrade this version of Java, if it breaks while we try to run the program, that'll effectively bring back feedback immediately. It can iterate on this feedback, and similarly, when tests run on that program that does finally run, it's also able to get those test results back and iterate on that quickly. This is clear and fast feedback, which doesn't exist in the same way in the real world. If we were able to understand very quickly if we were going to get customers launching a new product, there would be a lot less dead products out there. There aren't clear guidelines as to what we're developing. There's not clear feedback on if we did it right. A lot of times we need to talk to customers, or we need to talk to people in other departments or other specialists to be able to understand if the things that we've built are actually helpful. When we build things in software, a lot of the times those small tasks that we're working on are part of a larger initiative or epic, a larger understanding of what needs to change within our software space. Just because we did the subtask correctly doesn't mean we're on track for our larger goal. More customers, saving money, a number of other objectives. When developers work on problems, we look at a problem space. We try and understand how that software is going to change over time. And so depending on this, you can develop the same application in a variety of different ways using a variety of different techniques. If you focus on performance of the application, that means that the speed at which people are able to build new features for that application is going to be reduced. You're also not going to be able to change the features that you have built very easily because you need to keep factoring in the performance constraints. So it's a tug of war as we try and find the right place to focus within this space. And these are just three constraints. In reality, there's many others because the real thing that we're building isn't software. We aren't building software for the sake of software. We're building software for people. And again, most problems are people problems. There's actually a fantastic paper written about using agents to develop software where a group of agents were tasked with following a waterfall approach. A waterfall approach essentially has the developers first looking at designing the solution, then coding the solution, then testing the solution before finally documenting what they've built. This process is fine for building an initial software solution. However, when it comes to making changes or when there are misunderstandings at any of these different steps, the reality is that you could be building and shipping something that doesn't actually fit the need that you have. Now, or as you release something, you may realize that the need that you thought existed doesn't. So if we go back to this chart, even if we were able to task AI agents to work at a high speed, that ability to change is really the thing that's difficult. And even if we're able to land in somewhere where we're able to have high performance and high velocity and able to ship quickly, that is very efficient code, we still lose this ability to change, which means potentially having an AI agent have to rewrite everything every time we make a change. What would it be like if every release of your software, the UI changed? Because the constraints that you gave it were different. That could be the world of using AI agents as developers. But I think the larger issue to think about is really at what point is a job outdated? At what point does a job cease to be valuable? Because we're talking so much about dev jobs going away or getting destroyed, are these jobs actually being outdated or is something else happening? We can really think about calculation or doing mathematics for businesses as a clear kind of example of this. I think everyone's familiar with making handmade calculations using paper and kind of writing things down. This has been the tried and true way of doing a lot of things, and people still do it today. Eventually, around the 1600s, the slide rule was invented. The slide rule has these ruler-looking space that helps you do calculations very efficiently, very quickly. Many engineers were trained on how to do this, especially going into the 1800s, as after the Industrial Revolution, changed how businesses had to think. When you had a master and apprentice building individual nails and screws, you didn't have to even worry about having thousands of screws. You had to build each one. It was unfeasible to have that many. But as we needed more and more ability to create and construct in consistent and measured ways, we needed more mathematical approaches to the work that we did every day. Therefore, the slide rule became more popular and it was adopted. And that kind of led us to our first handmade calculator, which, of course, everyone has used today. Now your phones have it, but at the time, handheld calculation wasn't something that most people were able to access. And even in the 1960s, most people didn't. Slide rules still maintained a place in many businesses, and even NASA engineers did a lot of things by hand. But as computers became more prevalent through the 1970s, handheld calculators became a more obvious choice, and eventually we arrived at spreadsheets, which were developed in the 1980s. And spreadsheets were able to compute multiple calculations very quickly. As you updated rows, entire columns of data would change. And because there was this sort of relationship of data and a model or a database that you could kind of work with, we were able to very quickly adapt our businesses to thinking in spreadsheets. And spreadsheets are the ultimate database businesses still use today. And the internet accelerated spreadsheets to a massive degree to being able to be interactive, not being printouts anymore. And transformer AIs are the latest kind of change in how we think about work, how we think about computing, how we think about generating reports. So throughout this entire time, at what point did we really decide to stop doing mathematics and let computers take on math? At what point did we have less need for computation? Technology only grows. Our need for people, our need for jobs, our need for computation. So this idea that developer jobs are going to be replaced is a bit misguided. The work that we do will change, but the need isn't going to change. The need's just going to shift. And I'm sure you might still know people who don't use computers, or maybe don't even have one in their home, who think that computers are a phase. People get attached to the way that they do things. So are AI agents going to really replace developers? Are they going to replace people? The reality is most challenges in the real world aren't very well understood. People don't necessarily know all the factors that are in play, and giving these systems feedback is difficult. And when you develop software, you don't have clear right and wrong, clear feedback loops all the time. You need experts to be able to provide consistency and push back on software decision making. Unlimited velocity makes programs brittle and may leave companies in a bad place. And jobs will mostly grow. The roles and the responsibilities that people have is going to change. And so I think we can say goodbye to Java migrations, but that's going to open us up to a whole lot of different other opportunities for work that's interesting and exciting. And I'm looking forward to that time. If you enjoyed this discussion and you want to find more, you can find us over on our blog at Sable Discussion. Please subscribe and follow us there for more. And thanks very much for tuning in. Have a good day.